Large joints, exquisite dishes, preserves, the greatest variety of wines appeared successively upon the table, which was served at the king's expense, and of which expense Monsieur Colbert could have found no difficulty in saving 2/3, without any one in the Bastille being the worse for it. Baisemeaux was the only one who ate and drank with gastronomic resolution. Aramis allowed nothing to pass by him, but merely touched everything he took. Athos, after the soup and 3 hors d'oeuvres, ate nothing more. The style of conversation was such as might have been anticipated between 3 men so opposite in temper and ideas. Aramis was incessantly asking himself by what extraordinary chance Athos was there at Baisemeaux's, when D'Artagnan was no longer there, and why D'Artagnan did not remain when Athos was there. Athos sounded all the depths of the mind of Aramis, who lived in the midst of subterfuge, evasion, and intrigue. He studied his man well and thoroughly, and felt convinced that he was engaged upon some important project. And then he too began to think of his own personal affair, and to lose himself in conjectures as to D'Artagnan's reason for having left the Bastille so abruptly, and for leaving behind him a prisoner so badly introduced and so badly looked after by the prison authorities. But we shall not pause to examine into the thoughts and feelings of these personages, but will leave them to themselves, surrounded by the remains of poultry, game, and fish, which Baisemeaux's generous knife and fork had so mutilated. We are going to follow D'Artagnan instead, who, getting into the carriage which had brought him, said to the coachman, "Return to the palace, as fast as the horses can gallop." Chapter 64. What took place at the Louvre during the supper at the Bastille. Monsieur de Saint-Aignan had executed the commission with which the king had entrusted him for La Valliere, as we have already seen in one of the preceding chapters. But whatever his eloquence, he did not succeed in persuading the young girl that she had in the king a protector powerful enough for her under any combination of circumstances, and that she had no need of anyone else in the world when the king was on her side. In point of fact, at the very first word which the favorite mentioned of the discovery of the famous secret, Louise, in a passion of tears, abandoned herself in utter despair to a sorrow which would have been far from flattering for the king, if he had been a witness to it from one of the corners of the room. Saint-Aignan, in his character of ambassador, felt almost as greatly offended at it as his master himself would have been, and returned to inform the king that he had been seen and heard, and it is thus we find him in a state of great agitation in the presence of the king, who was, if possible, in a state of even greater flurry than himself. "But," said the king to the courtier, when the latter had finished his report, "what did she decide to do? Shall I at least see her presently before supper? Will she come to me, or shall I be obliged to go to her room?"
"I believe, sire, that if your majesty wishes to see her, you will not only have to take the first step in advance, but will have to go the whole way."
"That I do not mind." "Do you think she has yet a secret fancy for young Bragelonne?" muttered the king between his teeth.
"Oh, sire, that is not possible, for it is you alone, I am convinced, Mademoiselle de Valliere loves,
and that too with all her heart. But you know that the Bragelonne belongs to that proud race who play the part of Roman heroes."
The king smiled feebly. He knew how true the illustration was, for Athos had just left him.
"As for Mademoiselle de la Valliere," Saint-Aignan continued, "she was brought up under the care of the Dowager Madame, that is to say, in the greatest austerity and formality. This young engaged couple coldly exchanged their little vows in the prim presence of the moon and stars. And now, when they find they have to break those vows asunder, it plays the very deuce with them."
Saint-Aignan thought to have made the king laugh, but on the contrary, from a mere smile, Louis passed to the greatest seriousness of manner. He had already begun to experience that remorse which the comte had promised D'Artagnan he would inflict upon him. He reflected that, in fact, these young persons had loved and sworn fidelity to each other, that one of the two had kept his word, and that the other was too conscientious not to feel her perjury most bitterly.